In low orbit above, the barge Octavius waits, cyclonic torpedoes primed. Ventanus turns, he thinks of brothers lost, and looks at the brother with him. He holds out his mailed hand. The color sergeant passes him the standard. It is old and battered, dented, with a slight twist or two in the haft. Surely, the sergeant thinks, the damned thing could have been cleaned and mended. Ventanus takes it, honoring every mark upon it. He plants it upright in the burning rock of Colchis. The flickering firelight catches at the golden crest of the standard.
We march for Macrag,
the sergeant declares. No, not today, Ventanus replies. Today, we march for Calth. The Imperium struggle against the Warmaster's heresy is a tale marked by heroes and lunatics alike. Without the sacrifice of countless heroic souls, humanity would not survive such a cataclysmic war. For every valiant soul standing in the name of the Emperor shall be glorified for their service. And there are few souls more heroic than the legendary warrior of the Ultramarines Legion, the hero and savior of Calth, Remus Ventanus. Serving as captain of the 4th Company of the Ultramarines first chapter during the Great Crusade, Remus would be presented with the power sword, Phaeton, with his ascension to captain by chapter master of the 1st, Marius Gage. Overseeing Ventanus's deeds during the joint offensive of the Gazlak Orcs alongside the Wordbearer's Legion, his Primarch Roboute Guilliman would set Ventanus as the Erud muster point commander. Resenting being placed in an administerial role during the conflict, Remus would nevertheless attend to his duties, yet be embroiled with the first traitor offensive conducted against the 13th Legion, the Betrayal of Calth. The Wordbearers would fraternize with the Ultramarines Legion in an effort to mend the wounds inflicted upon the 17th Legion on the world of Monarchia. Converting the populace to worship the Emperor as a god, the Wordbearers would be shamed for their heretical actions by the Emperor of Mankind himself, with the Ultramarines and their Primarch, Roboute Guilliman, serving as witnesses and enforcers. Hoping to renew their bonds of brotherhood, the Ultramarines would stoically accept the Wordbearers' offer to begin anew, yet their trust would be repaid with treachery. Wordbearers whom had built bonds of trust with the Ultramarines under false pretenses would stab them in the back. Culling thousands of loyal Astartes with a surprise attack that would sow chaos throughout the command structure of the 13th Legion. As storied heroes of the Imperium were slain like cattle, the Ultramarines would struggle to organize under the disarray and subterfuge orchestrated by Primarch Lorgar Aurelian. Yet in its darkest moment, heroes of Calth would rise, with few more venerated than Remus Ventanus. Overseeing the loading operations of the Numinous port, Ventanus would bear witness to the destruction of Calth's Viridian anchor by the crash course of the Campanile. Despite the assertion that this catastrophe had been an accident, Ventanus would be rightly skeptical due to the damage incurred being so damning that even a trained Astartes, such as himself, couldn't hope to cause such damage deliberately. Discovering slain honor guard en route to a transport ship, Ventanus would verify that the Wordbearers had been the cause of the destruction. Forming Astartes of disparate chapters of the Legion into his 4th company, Ventanus would not hesitate in bringing the wrath of Ultramar to bear against their foes. Joining forces with the Mechanicum Magos, Analyticae Mir Ed Toran, the Tech Priest would devise a means to reactivate Calth's deactivated planetary defense grid to strike back against the Wordbearer fleet. Trusting only Astartes with the knowledge of their assault of the craft world, Gielfwa, Remus's men would include references to the amount of painted harlequins in the engagement, decipher false messages and interference from traitor forces. Contacting Marius Gage, whom commanded his forces from the Ultramarines' flagship, the Macrag's Honor, Ventanus would inform the Master of the First that the Wordbearer Force Commander, Morpal Gier, had surrendered, yet demanded the surrender of the 13th Legion. Rejecting such a poisoned chalice, Ventanus's subordinate, Captain Teus Sulus, would be enraged to slay the Wordbearer, with his goading that their genefather, Guilliman, had been slain. Reborn as the demon, Samus, Ventanus would briefly be rendered unconscious, yet upon waking, see the destruction left in the wake of the cursed being. Arming himself with the Athame dagger from Morpal's body, Ventanus would defeat Samos. Destroying the Athame with its purpose fulfilled, Ventanus would contact the Macragge's honor once more and be relieved to hear the voice of his Primarch. With the aid of Remus and his men, the Magos would succeed in her mission to reactivate the defense grid and wreak havoc on the traitor vessels. Yet Remus would be injured by the Galvorbach in the trying. Reinforced by the Ultramarines' 11th, 112th, and 19th companies, under the command of Captain Aphon, the Legio Titanica would also bear its might under the command of Tetrarch Tauro Nicodemus. As Roboute Guilliman declared his legion's command to retaliate against his former brother-in-arms, Remus would engage word-bearer forces at Leptius Numinus and Lancia Guildhall. Turning the tide against the word-bearers, Ventanus would lead his company of over 700 Astartes strong to counterattack the Sons of Lorgar. Yet First Captain Corpharon and First Chaplain Erebus of the 17th Legion would conduct a ritual to manipulate the warp to render the Star of Viridia unstable and bode ill for the civilian populace. Buying time for the Ultramarines on the surface of Calth to evacuate the planet, Ventanus and his men would face overwhelming odds in order to defend their vulnerable battle brothers. Despite the orders of his Primarch to evacuate, Ventanus would lead the remnant civilians in Astartes into the subterranean arcologies under the surface of Calth. Calth's sun would be poisoned by the taint of the warp and bombard Calth with radiation. The word bearers would attempt to withdraw, as Ventanus and his charges would wait for the bombardment to cease, as abandoned and expendable word bearers unable to escape the planet would perish on the surface. Within the arcologies, Mechanicum forces of the Tag Mater Omnisire would join the Ultramarines within the depths and lead the survivors deeper within the arcology. Yet remnants of the word bearers would delve within to combat the survivors of Calth. Beginning the Underground War. Leading the defense of the Arcology, Remus would face the dregs of the Wordbearer forces under the surface of Calth. For 7 solar years, the Underground War would wage. Ventanus would grow weary from the endless harrying of the 17th Legion, their demonic allies, and heretical strategies. Near its conclusion, Ventanus would mortally wound Dark Apostle Maelog Carfo, using the Athame known as the Shard of Erebus, during his luring into a trap to detonate a virus bomb within the Arcology. Changing the Wordbearer into a demon prince of Chaos Undivided, known as Makar. Yet alongside the virus bomb, he would be cast into a warp rift created by his own hand. After years of conflict, Ventanus and the survivors he had led to salvation would be rescued by the Ultramarines, and Ventanus would be hailed as the Saviour of Calth. Ascending to the role of advisor to the Primarch himself, Ventanus would contribute his experience and insights into the drafting of a new tome that would forever change the Adeptus Astartes, the Codex Astartes. Identifying crucial flaws within the tome, Guilliman would advise the new Codex as a guideline for future Astartes, rather than an ironclad dogmatic codified set of rules. With the Horus heresy concluded in the name of the loyalists to the throne, Remus Ventanus would be charged with the duty to conduct exterminatus of the Wordbearer homeworld of Colchis. Before the final assault of the traitor homeworld, Ventanus would plant upon the soil of Colchis a standard retrieved from the toxin-decimated surface of Calth, declaring that today the Ultramarines marched for Calth. They would purge the planet of life and achieve vengeance for their first and greatest betrayal of the Legion. Yet few Astartes of the Horus heresy would survive into the 41st millennium, and Remus Ventanus would not be such an exception. Interred within an ornate tomb of black marble, crafted by the hand of Roboute Guilliman personally, the Saviour of Calth would be heralded as one of the greatest heroes and exemplars of the Ultramarines Legion. Its location lost to time as the millennia waxed and waned. His tomb would be discovered once more during the 41st millennium by a child whom would one day become the captain of the Ultramarines' 4th Company, Uriel Ventress. This knowledge would be uncovered by the Iron Warrior Warsmith, Honsu, whom would, upon finding his tomb, retrieve the Shard of Erebus within the sarcophagus for his own means. Battle would break out between the Ultramarines and Iron Warriors within the tomb, and Ventress would once again arise to face the traitors. Though the saying, "only in death does duty end," may be an axiom of the Imperium, a select few refuse to relinquish their holy duty to destroy the enemies of the Emperor. And so, Remus Ventanus would lead the Legion of the Damned in aiding the Ultramarines' battle against the traitors. Burning with azure light and still faintly tinged with the sigils of his legion and green cloak of his panoply of war, the black armor-clad Ventanus would decimate the Iron Warriors, wielding an ornate golden bolter. Handing the now fully grown Uriel Ventress the Shard of Erebus, Remus would impart the true name of the demon Makar to his Ultramarine successor, the name being Melog Carfo. With his duty done, Ventanus and the Legion of the Damned would dissipate from the material realm, save in the knowledge that their intervention would save the Ultramarines from annihilation and preserve the life of its chapter master, Marnius Calgar. His legacy as a true hero of the Imperium would be enshrined with hundreds of monuments and temples dedicated to his bravery. Half of Calth's Mountains of Twilight would be sculpted into a grand gateway honoring his service, with the golden statue of the Saviour of Calth standing 100 meters tall, proudly standing vigil between the causeway of granite separating the irradiated wastelands from the habitable sectors of Calth. His heroism plain to see, for anyone foolish enough to wage war on the battle-scarred bastion of Calth. A dazzling tower of light flashes from space, briefly linking an orbital lance battery with the surface of Calth. The shell-punctured roof of the terminal lifts off in a rush of explosive kinetic force before vanishing in a cloud of fire. Ventanus nods in satisfaction and returns the standard to Sergeant Barker. He preempts Celaton's question of the lance strike's timing before it is asked. "Why didn't I hit them with the lance strike in the first place?" "Because I want the last sight of every word bearer to be an Ultramarine." This has been a tale of the great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Remus Ventanus never faltered in his defiance against the traitors to the throne. His glory is etched in history for never relenting in his battle against the worst of creation's malevolent forces. So too must we all stand against the hubris and machinations of the ruinous powers, for none can eclipse the glory of those who even in death face the darkness.